This is TV Sunday, the power of truth.
Today we have quite different story to tell to you. One of the magnificent attorney at law who already served so much of public services for New York State and many more. So he's a wonderful advocate and right activist as well. Today we are discussing with her in different capacity as she became the first ever elected South Asian American to the office of New York State Assembly. Ladies and gentlemen, let me welcome one of the powerful lady and magnificent leader, Jenifer Rajkumar. Welcome. It's a great honor to welcome you in this studio.
Thank you, Kiran. I'm so happy to be with you on TV Sunday.
Choose from where can I start? Because you have so much of, you know, track records and wonderful achievements as well. But if I want to know that you already had a great success in your profession as a lawyer, as a civil activist, community organizer, what made you to choose this path? I mean, the career of politicians.
Well, you need power
to
get anything done for people.
Right.
So I realized to be a true advocate for vulnerable people,
yes,
I needed power.
Right.
And that's why I became a politician, an elected leader. And that's why I left my life as a lawyer and my life as the director of immigration for New York State,
yes,
to run for office so I could serve the people. And in my current capacity, I get to work for the people day and night, advocating for them and making sure that they have a seat at the table of power.
Right. Were you quite satisfied with your profession as a lawyer?
Yes.
You had a degree from Stanford, right?
Yes, correct.
That was really big.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
I loved it.
Yeah.
And I dedicated my life as a lawyer to civil rights law.
Yes.
So standing up for the vulnerable and the voiceless.
Voiceless.
And right out of law school, I was actually,
oh my God,
when I did my first big case.
Oh.
And that was on behalf of 5,000 women who had experienced discrimination.
Yeah.
Basically, when they got pregnant, they were demoted or fired. And they didn't get paid equally to men on the job. So I was honored to represent these 5,000 women. And in the end, we won the case. And the UN called it one of the top 10 cases in the world. And
yes,
women's equality.
Yes.
And I was young at the time. But when I look back, I'm so grateful that I had the opportunity to advocate at such a young age for people who needed it.
I already said on my opening announcement that you are the first South Asian American who hold that position, the office in the New York State. What is the speciality having that title?
It's an honor and a privilege and a responsibility. I owe it a lot to the leaders of our community who paved the way.
Yeah.
I owe it to having an incredible family.
Right.
And I owe it to the hard work of myself and my team. But as the first South Asian woman elected to a state office, I'm trying to bring up the rest of the community. So our community works very hard. We work 25 hours a day.
Yeah, of course.
But we just need guidance. And it's my responsibility to help guide our community so they can navigate America, navigate our courtrooms, navigate our educational institutions, navigate government. So that's what my office is here for. And I'm also here to bring up the youth.
Right.
That's why I'm proud to say that in my office, we have so many South Asian American youth, and I'm trying to open the doors for them.
If we talk about the struggle of your family, as I said, they paved their journey from South Asia, India to United States, and they had so much of a struggle to grow up. If you look up to the struggle of your family, look back to the struggle of your family, what is the story behind it?
So my mom was born in a mud hut in India.
Yes.
And my parents came to the U.S. in the 70s.
With $300 check, right?
Exactly right.
Yes, yes.
You got it right.
Yes.
Just $300 and a suitcase.
Suitcase.
But they worked very hard.
Of course.
And they were able to realize.
When was it? It was like in 1980s or?
In 1970s.
1970s, oh yeah.
And they were able to realize the American dream. And I'm so grateful for all of the opportunity that this great country,
yes,
provided my family.
Yes.
And now I get to honor my country every day.
Of course. Are you still connected with India like your parents were from there? How much is your connection?
It's a very strong connection. So I will tell you that when my parents came here, my mom was very proud of democracy. And India, where they came from, is one of the world's largest democracies.
Of course.
So she would always say at home, this is a democratic household. So whenever there was a fight in the house, we solved it through the family court system that my mom implemented. So what that meant is we would all gather in the kitchen, and one person would be a judge.
Right.
One person would be a lawyer for one side. Oh. One person would be a lawyer for the other side. And as a family, we would just argue it out. So I grew up with this family court system.
All right.
And I believe that was normal.
So that encouraged you to choose the path in law.
Exactly. Years later, I became a lawyer. And my mom still wonders why.
Yeah.
So I grew up with these values at home that came from India, that came from South Asia. And I'm very close with my family in India still. And throughout the years, I have visited many, many times.
How difficult is it to come up to this stage from that family? This is very interesting to know, because lots of the people from who came from 90s, 70s, 80s or 90s, their next generation are attempting something into the mainstream politics or somewhere. But it's still very hard for them. They feel something like that. And lots of people with whom I had an interview, chance of having interview, they say something like that, oh, it's still very difficult because we don't have this, we don't have that, with this and that. But you are one of the role model for all of them, that you achieved something great. How difficult was this path you passed already?
It was difficult.
It was difficult.
To become elected.
Yeah.
Because nobody had done it before from our community.
Yes, yes.
And a lot of people said it was impossible. They said, you're a nice girl.
Yeah.
Here.
Yeah.
But we worked very hard, and we started from nothing.
Yeah.
We literally had no office.
Yeah. Oh.
And I remember knocking on doors in the freezing cold weather. And people were wondering, oh, who's this girl? What is she saying? But in the end, we created a big movement. And
of
now
course.
Here I am, the elected state representative. So that is all the hard work of our culture.
Hard work.
We are very hardworking people.
Of course.
The Pali Americans, South Asian Americans, Indians.
Yes.
Guyanese Americans, very hardworking. And so I just amplified the values of our community.
Right.
And that's how I got elected. But it took a lot of persistence.
Of course.
I just did not give up.
Yes.
And I worked very hard. And my dad used to always tell me the story of Arjuna from the Mahabharata.
Arjuna, yes.
Yeah. And so Arjuna was able to shoot a bird. He was the only one of the Pandava brothers that could shoot the bird.
Yeah.
And my dad always said to me, why? The reason is, he only saw the eye of the bird. So my dad always said, focus on the eye of the bird.
Yes.
Always focus.
Focus on your goal.
Focus on your goals, then you can make your dreams come true. So it was through all of these South Asian values.
You have so many different communities in your constituency, District 38. Probably one of the most diverse in the New York City, or maybe in the planet, I say.
Thank you.
That is Jacksonite, I would say most diverse in the planet. But yours as well have some character. People from different part of the world, and they practice the different ethnicity, different background, different cultures. But you are the leader of all of them. What is your key experience working with the different communities and with the different ethnic backgrounds, different identities?
It was a beautiful experience. I was adopted by the Latino community.
Great.
And it warms my heart whenever I think about it, how I was adopted as their own.
Uh-huh.
And there's very warm interactions I have with the Latino community. I'm very close to my Dominican constituents. And I think what I'm so proud of is how I was able to cross-cut with all the different communities. And in the end, we won across ideology. Conservative Democrats and Liberal Democrats all voted for me.
All voted,
People from both parties.
Yes.
And people from all ethnicities.
Yes.
And I'm very proud of that.
Do you think that you have done so proper job to address their issues?
Just like I was adopted by the communities, I've also adopted them as my own. And so I always am at church.
Yes.
I am at Gurdwara with the Sikh community. I'm at the Hindu temples. I'm at the mosques.
Right.
I'm everywhere because all of them are my people.
Of course. Apart from you, maybe there are other examples as well from the South Asian community who made this possible. But lots of people still afraid to come up to this stage. They even afraid to come to the political movement, political activities, even for vote. So what do you think about it? And how can we encourage those people to come to this stage like you are here?
I think it's important to take just the first step. So if you're afraid of getting involved, what I would do is go to one community meeting.
Yes.
Or go to one political event. And if you want to help with that event, you can always call me.
Yes.
So anyone is welcome to contact me. And I'll help you take that first step. And after you take the first step, then you can go from there. So if you're afraid of something, I would say just take one small step.
Yes.
And then see where it may lead. Like, I did not plan on going into politics.
Yes.
This was not part of my plan.
You had not planned on that.
But you never know where your journey takes you. And I wanted to find a way to help
What do you
people.
Want it to be exactly? No, I don't want to say I wanted to be you already something, but what was your plan?
Well, I grew up in a family of all doctors.
Oh my, that's my
So I always say I'm the black sheep. My family of all doctors. So what I saw was them helping people every day.
Yes.
So I thought I want to be a doctor or I want to be a writer. Then I said I want to be a lawyer. But what I really wanted to be was a doctor for the whole country. And when you go into politics, that's essentially what you are.
Of course. So that you have power to change if you are in politics. But a doctor cannot change the policy.
Exactly.
Is that the reason you choose this path?
Yes. See, I'm inspired by doctors because they save lives every day.
Yes.
But good leaders,
yes,
they save lives every day also.
So you were already served as the director of immigration affairs from New York State, right?
Yes.
In 17 to 19.
Correct.
I believe that were probably the most difficult time that immigrants' family were facing due to the administration in White House.
Yes.
So how you like to recall those 2 years and what were your real contribution?
Exactly right.
Yeah.
Those were Trump's first 2 years as president.
Yeah.
And during that time, he was saying a lot of things like he wants to build a wall to prevent immigrants from coming. He wanted to ban Muslims from entering our country.
Right.
So this is the time I was directing immigration for the state.
Right.
So I got...
It was really a tough time you were there.
Correct.
Tough.
So he instituted the Muslim ban as soon as I started my job.
Yeah.
And when he instituted the Muslim ban, I called the state and I said, would you like me to start early? Because so much was happening with excluding immigrants. And I believe in what the Statue of Liberty says.
Yes.
Give me your poor, give me your hungry, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free.
Yeah.
We are a country of inclusion.
Yes.
And the good part, though, was that people began to pay attention to immigrants. And there was a lot of energy out there to stick up for their rights.
Yes.
And as a result of this, we were able to secure $31 million fund a completely new program to help immigrants. And what this program did was provide lawyers for all immigrants who needed them. So this was a first in the nation project.
Is that something like pro bono lawyer or
exactly
state sponsor?
Yes, free lawyers for everyone who needed them.
Right.
This was a first in the nation project that I got to lead. I'm so honored that I got to create and build this project. So what happened is we were able to provide lawyers for people who are alone in detention.
Yes.
Not able to speak the language,
with
no representation. And we were able to provide help to these people in these dark moments.
Yes, and as you mentioned, that what Statue of Liberty says, you already had a project under its name, that Liberty Defense, right?
Exactly.
What is that exactly?
So the project's name is the New York State Liberty Defense Project. And I'll never forget, there was once a high school kid who was a straight-A student. And he was on the train where he was picked up by ICE. And his mother was very, very scared, and she called. She had no idea where her son was.
Wow.
He was in detention for a week. And I was able to secure representation, and he came home. And I'll never forget when she called me, and she said, you're an angel, and thank you for bringing my son home. These are the stories that I remember, and that I treasure.
So you decided to start that project, or what? Exactly what the project is, I wanted to know. What does it do?
The project provides lawyers to immigrants who need them in immigration proceedings. So deportation proceedings, asylum proceedings. And I believe that everyone on American soil has the right to be treated with certain dignity and respect.
Of course.
Just by virtue of being on American soil, you have the right to certain dignity because that's who we are. So when you provide lawyers to immigrants, they have the right to be heard.
Yes.
And I believe that in America, everyone should have that fundamental right to be heard.
The best thing you have is you are really accessible for all the people that needs you. You're
Thank
accessible.
You. Thank you
Most
so much.
Of the time, you pick phone by yourself and you talk by yourself. I mean, when people need you, you talk and you present there. That is the best character of politicians or a public servant, what you are. That's really great, I think. And that encourages a lot of us. What is your best part in your personal life you want to highlight? What is the best thing?
My personal life? I would say lately, I love getting to go and spend time with my parents.
Great.
I find that the older you get, the more you come to value everything that your family has done for you. And I find that the older I get, the more loving I get.
Of course.
So I would say that. I also love poetry in my free time.
Yes.
I love to read poetry. Mm-hmm. I can recite always poetry for you anytime you want it.
Do you remember anything from Haribang Sarai Bachchan?
Not yet, but share
but you
it
have
with me.
Read that,
yes.
Yeah. Have you written as well?
Oh, yes. I write my own poetry since I was a child. It's my first love in life is poetry.
First love in life.
And I also love the great political speeches.
Yes. Something like President Obama.
Oh, yes. He's one of our greatest orators.
Yeah.
But also, lately I've loved Teddy Roosevelt.
Oh, Roosevelt.
Teddy Roosevelt, who had his famous Man in the Arena speech. It's one of my favorite speeches of all time, where he says, "It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The courage belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly." These beautiful words.
That's outstanding.
Thank you.
Do you believe King Jr. as well? Martin Luther?
Oh, absolutely. Martin Luther King, letter from Birmingham Jail.
Yes. The reason why I remember him is that he is one of the most famous speech he delivered in front of White House, I think, in 1961. I have a dream.
Yes.
So I believe that you also inspire lots of people, especially young immigrants who are from South Asia or any part of the world. Do you sometimes feel that I have so much of responsibility, or you feel that I have right?
I feel mostly like I have responsibility. That's what I feel every day. We're talking about political speeches. Well, JFK, he said, ask not what your country can do for you. Ask what you can do for your country. And I think he hit the nail on the head. We always have to be asking, what can we do? How can I work my hardest? And my whole team does the same thing. Well, the other thing, though, is after I won my big primary election, and not only did we won by the largest of any challenger in the state.
The largest margin.
Yes.
Yes.
So, and we're so proud. And so because of those phone calls, I feel an enormous sense of responsibility.
What is the major character of your constituency?
When I think of District 38, I think of very warm people, very hardworking. The people in my district are willing to work as hard as necessary.
Right.
Now they just need a way to come up. So I think that people that work this hard should have the doors opened for them.
Yeah.
And that's what I strive to do.
I believe that you are a member of a small business as well, right, state office.
Yes.
So because of this pandemic, COVID-19, lots of small businesses were suffering a lot. And what is the process of government to helping them?
The small business owners have to cut through so much red tape that makes it very difficult. My job to ease those burdens on the small business owners. So what I've tried to do is we instituted an eviction moratorium for small businesses during the pandemic so they couldn't be kicked out of their space.
Right.
And we tried to make life as easy as we could, and we still do every day for these small business owners.
They are still struggling a lot. Is there any financial help or something like that?
There are all kinds of grants and tax credits that small business owners can apply for.
Yeah.
It's very tricky sometimes
of course.
For owners to know where to go,
yes.
What resources is available, what help is available. So my office is here to make life easier, to help you, tell you where you can go to get help.
Yes. How people, if they're watching us right now and they want to reach out to you, is it possible they can talk to you direct or your staffs are there to support
them? Absolutely. So everyone who's watching, you can always contact me directly, and I would love to hear from you.
Yes.
You can reach me on social media, Facebook,
yes.
Twitter, Instagram, just direct message me. You can call my office, you can find my information all over the internet, and I would love to hear from you.
Yeah, and would you mind to give your email address as well, so that people reach out to your office?
Absolutely. Rajkumar J at nyassembly.gov.
Right. What message you want to deliver to the young people?
I would say to young people, be passionate, follow your passions no matter what.
Yeah.
Always be respectful.
Yeah.
And be curious. Go talk to all different people and learn, soak in the knowledge.
Right.
And keep an open mind,
right.
Because your friends and allies can come in all forms.
Let's change the topics and something like I want to grab your attention regarding Nepalese American community. What is your reading Nepal regarding Nepalese American community?
I think it's a very warm community. I love the Nepali American community. I love the community. And I think that it's an up-and-coming community.
Yeah.
That is finding its political voice. And so my goal is to try to amplify the political voice of Nepali Americans.
So
we are creating, well, we created this year, for the first time ever, Nepal Day in New York State.
Of course.
And there was great enthusiasm for that.
Yeah.
And also, next year, for the first time, New York State will recognize Mount Everest Day.
Right.
So these are exciting initiatives, but this is just the beginning. I want to make sure that more Nepali youth are involved in government.
Right.
And I'm going to try to open doors for the community. Also, we need to make sure that more government documents are in Nepali language.
Of course, as I said, that not only the South Asian, like Nepalese are also starting their, you know, path towards the mainstream politics. Some of our friends are, you know, trying to jump there. As a mentor, what is your suggestion for them?
Call me. That's my suggestion.
Yeah.
For any young people in our community trying to get involved, please reach out to me. I will be happy to help.
Would you mind to say something to your audience, to our audience, that what is meant to be success to you?
Success.
What is your future plan initially, if you want to tell?
My future plan, I'm striving to be the best assemblywoman that I can possibly be.
Yeah.
And then from there, we will see.
Of course. We wish you all the best in your coming tenure as well.
Thank you so much.
And would you mind to say something to your audience, I mean voters, or your
Absolutely.
People living in your country?
Well, first I just want to say I'm grateful for your friendship.
Thank you.
And
it's same honor for me.
I applaud TV Sunday.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And I just want to say to everybody that I love you so much. I know the past 14 months have been very difficult with the COVID-19 pandemic. But everybody stay strong and know that I am always here for you.
Thank you very much, Jenifer. It's a great honor welcoming you in this studio.
Thank you
so much.
This is TV Sunday, the power of truth.